Did you guys plan to go after the noodling?
No, it's just happened every day. I'll decide to go.
I've lost my habit. Fishing or noodling?
Hey, good afternoon, everyone. I'm Jeff Murphy, and this is Roy Price, our partner. We're here this afternoon to talk to you about another fishing story or information, and that is we give you fishing 101.
No noodling.
No noodling. This is the good fishing. Our learning objectives today. Okay. Could I get one person to volunteer and read our learning objectives today?
Okay, after this presentation, you will be able to describe at least three benefits of fishing. Given a hook and bait, demonstrate the proper method of baiting a hook. Okay.
So basically what we're saying is that when you're done here, you'll be able to identify what fishing is. Not just with the theory or what you may think it is, but hopefully we'll give you something that says what fishing is. We're also going to have a demonstration as to how to get you started fishing by giving you worm and the hooks. We're going to teach you how to bait the hook. Okay? Not icky, but really good. Okay. Benefits of fishing. Our first benefit is catching fish. That's basically what we go fishing for most of us. Let's go catch fish, maybe what we do with them depends. But that would be number one. We want to catch a fish. And in catching fish, you normally have the thrill of catching fish. So once you start fishing, once you get in the habit of fishing, you start to get an understanding that it's a little bit more to it than just getting the fish up and it's in the boat. There's a lot of little intricate details that happen. When your line jiggles and you think that there's a fish on a line, you hook that fish. You know, that's the first thing. You feel like it's the adrenaline. You feel like you hooked them. Now you are fighting that fish. He's got to come in. He may be swimming away from you. You don't know what's on the other line. So these are the adrenaline rushes that you get with that. You know, so you don't know what you have. Catfish, you can have a trout, you can have a shark, you can have anything, just depending on what you're fishing. So you give you a little adrenaline. The anticipation of you visualizing yourself, getting that fish to you, getting him into the boat, what you have, taking pictures, you know, camaraderie with your friends and so forth. So those are a couple of the anticipated and the adrenaline rushes that you get by fishing. The skill of fishing. Now that's when you get into more you're out of the novice, if you will. So now you have things you're going to think about, such as your weather. You know, where you're going to fish. Is it going to be a pond, the ocean? You know, are you going to fish a stream or a river? Those type of things. You may have to adjust for temperature, wind direction. You may have to find the fish as far as the location of them. Are they at rocks? Are they at creeks? Are they in coves or things of that nature? So that's getting to more of your skill set of fishing. Knowing how to catch the fish, that's going to be another skill set. So you want to know how to set that hook. You know, do you jerk too hard? Jerk the hook right out the mouth? Do you jerk just enough to set the hook? Are you real in? Do you reel hard? Do you reel, release a little reel? So these are things that you'll get into as you become fishing people.
That's objective is what? Catching fish.
Right? And then knowing your local regulations. So now that's when you're going to know, you know, whether a license is required. So, you know, you have some captains that have license that's available for any member of the boat, of the crew. Then if you're out on your own, you may be bank fishing, you may get Parks and Recreation comes up and say, hey, do you have a license? License? I just thought I was just out here fishing. But because of conservation and so forth, they do have limits on the amount of fish that you can take with you, the size of the fish. Normally the small ones you want to keep back, the larger ones you can take, but they're usually in limits. Like the quantity that you can take with you. So you want to know your local regulations, your licenses, and so forth. You also want to know what you can and can't keep. Do you need licensing for your boat? How charter regulations and things of that nature, like preservers, things of that nature when you get out to fish. Okay. So again, our first benefit is catching the fish. Our second benefit is nature. But how many people thought nature would be fishing? Okay, so some people are fishing. So fishing is not just about going out and catching a fish. That's the benefit. But what fishing is actually going out and enjoying nature. It's being a part of nature. You're taking back nature, if you decide you want to keep the fish or what have you. But it is just, it's a part of nature. So even if you don't catch a fish, you still can take pictures of your scenery, with your surroundings, things of that nature. You get, if you like to travel, you can go to different places to fish for different types of fish, charters or things of that nature in which you do get an opportunity, to explore the beauty of the land that you may be fishing on. Then, of course, the seasonal fishing. You have the spawning season, that's the spring season. For salmon, you may have it in the early fall season. So now you're enjoying your seasons. You may ice fish the winter season. So you have different seasons that you can fish. So a lot of people believe that fishing is just about, in the summertime, you go out there with your lemonade, you sit back under the shade tree, throw it out, and that. But it's a lot more to it. And if you become more familiar with the art of fishing, you'll start to become more of a fishing person. Eco-friendly practices. Of course, when you're out in nature, just like smoke the bear, we don't get out on those cigarettes down, campfires and things of that nature. You're gonna make sure that you are taking care of the land that you want. That's one of the major factors of fishing is that the sport. You are now becoming a part of a family, and families have rules. So once you learn these rules on how to take care of your environment, you become more environmentally friendly. Of course, the laws of the land and decide what to keep. We talked about that a little bit, going back some of the small ones so they can have a chance to grow and also conserve the fish for future generations and things of that nature. My third benefit of fishing is the sport. So how many people have seen like bass fishing sports competitions or flicked through the channel, maybe ran across one to know about it? So a lot of people fish for sports. They fish so that it's a competition to see who can catch the biggest fish. They may fish, they'll take them as taxidermist purposes to hang on the wall. You may get a big marlin, you want to hang that, have a taxidermist and hang on the wall, things of that nature. So it's a sport of fishing. And a lot of times, fishing is not just about catching and taking and freezing them and eating them. It's about sometimes you fish just for the purpose of just catching one, you throw it back. That's another way to protect the environment, so we're not taking everything with us. Getting catch and release, and then it's friendly rivalry. Me and my buddy Roy, we can say, let's go out fishing, let's see who catches the biggest fish. Dinner's on you. If I catch the biggest fish, maybe it's on me. You catch the biggest fish.
That's the first fish.
So, and it's the socialization part of it. Of course, you go out with your friends and family. Now, you're not just fishing. You are socializing. You're spending time with your friends, your family. You're making new friends. You may be out. If you're in a charter, sometimes you don't charter just by yourself. You have people that you've never met, but you have a common goal. So it makes a little bit breaking the ice of making new friends a lot easier. Then solitude. So basically what this is I work 6 days this week, I am tired as heck. I just want to go out and, sit back, cast it out, relax, and fish. And this individual exploration. So if you want to go out just and explore, you may go hiking with a fishing rod. Just go out and enjoy nature amongst yourself, relaxation, things of that nature, and even challenge yourself to hone in on your skills. So those are the three benefits of fishing. Okay, so can I get one person to tell me one of the benefits?
Catching
the fish. Communing with nature.
Solitude.
And solitude. Those are the three benefits of fishing. So it's not just about throwing it out there and catching the fish or whatever, but there's other things there that you may find to your liking and enjoying. Okay, that's going to be up as my partner, Roy, and he's going to talk about fishing equipment.
You always tell real fishermen, it starts off like this. The fish I caught was this thing. Now, there's all kinds of equipment that you have out there. You know, boats, the rods, you can get the equipment you can wear and everything else. I mean, we could spend hours and days just doing that. So we're going to limit our scope here a little bit. We're going to look at primarily the fishing hooks and the baits. They can have a normal J hook, which is just like a J, strangely enough. They come barbed and unbarbed. The barbed ones usually is because I'm going to keep this fish and I don't want him getting off the end. That's what the barb does. It helps him from slipping off. For those of us who like to do catch and release, we'll have an unbarbed hook. Basically, it comes out on there, no barb, the fish can slip off very easy, so it takes a lot more skill. If you're back to the original slides, one of the things is, this is a sport. How can I keep that on there? It's me against that fish. Who's going to win? Multi-hooks. Usually you see the treble hooks, you know, hooks with more than one barb on there, more than one hook on there. Or sometimes you'll see a line with a couple of hooks on it. And they're used for different purposes. But they all have one thing in common. They're very sharp. A dull hook does you no good. Types of baits. Artificials. Some people like tying their own flies. Fly fishing, or dry fly fishing, wet fly fishing. People will take and make an art just out of tying the flies, but don't ever go and fishing at all. It's very, very therapeutic for some individuals. You also have spinners, spoons, jigs, plugs, and there's many, many names you can use for the artificial types of fishing lures that are out there. They usually kind of look like plastic fish, worms, frogs, leeches. If it's out there in nature, we probably have a man-made equivalent that they can say, well, you know what, this kind of looks like a leech. We'll use that. And of course, we have the natural baits. You know, minnows, fish eggs, grasshoppers, maggots. We call them mealworms because it sounds nicer. Then you have that third category. It doesn't really seem to fit in either one nicely. You know, corn, bread, hot dogs, whatever you can kind of throw out there. Chicken necks with a catfish. We kind of consider them as natural baits because unlike artificials, you can't use them over and over again. And, you know, 20 which says, we make up the rules, so we're going to put them in whatever category we want to. Okay, we're going to have a demonstration out there. I need to pass out these high-tech fishing devices, or as 20 would say, HTFD, I guess. And a worm, if you would please. What we really wanted to do was teach you how to fish with live squid, but you know what? We had problems finding live squid this time of year. I must apologize for that. I would rather have done that for you. So instead, we're going to do how to hook an artificial worm. Everybody has to get a worm. This is a demonstration project. Now you will notice on your high-tech fishing devices that you get them, that they're an unbarbed hook. Also, you'll notice, because we're at the academy here, thinking of your safety, that they're very dull. That is not the normal fishing hook, ladies and gentlemen. All right, rules when poking the bait. When you are casting your line out there, rule number one, the bait must stay on the hook when casting. Otherwise, it does you no good. Rule number two, refer to rule number one. We got any more worms out there?
Oh, here's some worms.
Yeah. Set them on up.
Everyone have one? Yes.
Rule number three.
We need one.
Okay. Rule number three. Stick only the worm, not yourself. Very important. Those sharp hooks are hard to get out once they get into your skin. Now, we won't have that problem here today because we follow that ahead of time. Where's our worms at? You got any experts?
Don't eat any worms.
Yeah, we need one more worm. There we go. I knew there was enough on there. Okay, you want to take your nice artificial worm, take your high-tech fishing device, and you start the head of the worm, and you place it into the hook, and it goes right through the body. And you kind of thread, it's like a sock on your leg. And it goes on and up. Now then, remember with live worms, they're taking it, don't worry about the little bit of blood and the kind of squishing on you and squiggling around. When you do this, you don't feel a thing. You do it right. And as they take it, they get towards the top of your hook. On a real worm, what you would do is you'd actually leave the barb inside the bait. Because when the fish bites on it, and you set that hook, it will come through the bait. But with artificial worms, because they're kind of hard and rubbery, what happens is it won't come out. So what you're going to do on an artificial worm is you would take and have your hook, once it gets to the head, coming out.
Remember for larger worms, the diagram 3 is an ideal way of baiting your hook as well.
So it kind of looks something like that. Isn't that scrumptious little bit? Bite on that. Mm-hmm. It
smells good too.
Still smells real? I said it smells good. So what you do after you get this, obviously you're already on your line, you're going to cast it out there, and what's rule number one?
Got to stay on the hook,
which is usually not a problem with the artificial worms. However, with the real worms, they will come off. Or if you use grasshoppers or whatever else, because it doesn't have to be limited to worms. A lot of times we have, when we talk about leeches, grasshoppers, frogs. If it's out there, we'll take it and use it as bait. You can be very creative. Sometimes with the tiny little worms, you end up sticking two or three onto the same hook. Whole idea is it's something for that fish to bite onto. And this is great for doing value fishing for those catfish. I'm doing top fishing, using that little bobber kind of sitting around. I just kick back on that little stump there, wait till the bobber goes down and haul that fish in. Worms and other types of artificial bait can be used for all kinds of fishing. But they have to stay on the hook, otherwise all you got is a piece of metal in the water that's kind of floating around.
You fed the fish.
And you fancy fish. And they say thank you. So, today you were able to describe these three benefits of fishing, which were?
Nature.
Catching
fish.
Sport.
Solitude.
Camaraderie.
Workout. Yeah. But that is, in that sense it is, sport is part of fishing. So you are definitely right as well. But we're just looking for three.
And given a hook and a bait, you demonstrate how to proper method of baiting the hook. Proper method being that when you cast it, it stays on the hook. And we pass out to you because you're all going to be successful, correct? You have to have a fish recipe to
cook your first fish. So congratulations, you are now all fisher people.
Fisher Graduates Fishing 101. Any questions about fishing?
Can fish see the hook? If you have the hook sticking out of the side of a worm, will the fish avoid it because they'll be smart enough to be like, oh, I see a hook?
Well, some fish see, some fish smell.
Okay.
That's why we like with a spinner, it's a flashy little thing that spins in the water. Some fish, their senses is by sight. They see something looks like a limp fish, they're attacked. And others are smell. They're looking for that smell.
Fresh baked cornbread.
And one little secret, matter of fact, if you really want, if you're out on a boat perhaps, and you want to attract fish, some people, they'll take the bait, dump it over, like a tub of it, dump it over where fish will start coming in that area. Pop their line out, and they'll just...
That's called chumming.
Chumming.
Yeah. When you're out at sea, and you're throwing off the side, by the way, it's also called chumming.
Any other questions? All right, well, thank you for your attention and your time.
All right, thank you guys. What did the class say? Got any feedback? Yep.
Excellent use of cheap, easy to use.
Yeah.
I like that it was nice and dull, so I didn't poke myself at all.
Yeah.
What else?
Good visuals.
I'm sorry?
Good visuals.
Right. What made them good visuals?
Clear.
Yeah.
And it went well with the background since they were talking about fishing. They had the water background, so that made it really appealing. Mm-hmm. And the nature scene.
Yeah. It was fun, you know, entertaining.
They got the repetition in without being like beating at a dead horse, because sometimes there's like a fine line between like getting the, you know, but I thought that this worked really well.
Yeah, and you guys also assess partway through and then at the end. So we want to do that partway through mostly because if we get to the end and nobody knows the answer, we don't have any more time to train. So that gives you the opportunity to go back if somebody didn't get the answer, but we did. So that was great structure. Thank you. What else? That's it?
Mm-hmm.
Are you guys both fishermen?
Yeah. I think that was obvious.
You may not have said anything about what you asked, but y'all did great, and we know you're a fisherman. Mm-hmm. You gave us the recipe.
And they were enthusiastic.
Yeah.
And it was sincere. Their enthusiasm was very sincere. I did want to take another look at your objective, though. Can I see your objective again? After this presentation, you will be able to, in your first objective, describe at least three benefits of fishing. Okay, can anyone tell me where the action is there?
Describe.
The condition.
After this presentation.
Following this presentation and the standard.
Three.
Okay, and the second objective, the action?
Demonstrate.
The condition?
Given
the hook and bait. And the standard?
The proper.
Is the proper method the standard? Remember, what is the standard? It's the how well. And it's the proper method. So it's a little tricky sometimes to your action, condition, and standard must be very clear to the participant. Okay? So the proper method, even though that is your standard, not everyone was sure about whether that was the standard. So it needs to be very clear.
That's why I kind of emphasize the proper method is when you cast it, it's the rule.
Yeah, okay.
That's what we're trying to do, bring it to that as far as what's the problem. The word is alluding to without it falling off of the hook.
Right,
so,
okay.
So we have three examples of what it looks like with the problem.
Okay, very good, thank you.
that one is.
Let's initialize it during break so that we can keep moving forward.
Okay.
Because I'm afraid we're going to run out of time if we do it after each one.